Very good morning to everybody to this third session of the two-day Welcome NO national webinar on media profession today, issues and concerns. In the last two sessions, we heard the impact of modern developments on digital media and print media and the strategies to cope up with emerging problems. We found that problems are really doors to opportunities. This third session, we will be looking at what is happening to the film media and professionals attached to it. I am sure most of you might have heard about Bhoomi Geetha. It was a directional debut Kannada feature film made 97-98. It won several awards, including President's Medal for the best film on environment, preservation and conservation at the National Film Awards 1998. It also participated in Sao Paulo International Film Festival and the Global Earth Vision Film Festival in Tokyo. What's more interesting is it was a directorial debut of a great person. The director of Bhoomi Geetha, is here today with us. Let us invite Kesari Harwu for animating this session. Mr. Kesari Harwu has directed another movie, Ollayavanam, in 2006. He has also made documentaries on K.S. Puttanaiya, a prominent leader of farmers' movement in Karnataka. He has made a few non-feature films on Western Ghats, the thickly wooded and ecologically more sensitive mountain range that runs along the western coast of peninsular India. He has studied the problems of the coconut farmers whose livelihood was badly affected due to government development projects. When we watch all his contributions, a recurring theme we observe is the human being as with their relations with nature and how they are affected or influenced by modernity and globalization. Hi friends, not only this, he's an interesting human being that anybody would like to befriend. I am sure we'll have a heart-filling learning experience ahead of us. I welcome you all to today's learning experience with Mr. Kesari Harwu, the famous director of Bhoomi Geetha. Welcome you, sir.
Good morning to be here with you all and speak about the digital filmmaking and the impacts of digital filmmaking to the film industry and film as a medium. I will be speaking in English, and people who want to ask questions, they can ask questions even in Kannada and English, both. I can answer in both the languages. Today, I should be talking about a glance of the film industry or filmmaking process before the digital era, and also filmmaking and exhibition. See, these two things are very major sectors of the film industry and film medium. One is filmmaking and another is film exhibition. So I should be talking how they were there before the digitalization. And what was the impetus that gave to digitalize the filmmaking and exhibition is the next topic I would be speaking about. And the third one will be the impact of digitalization on filmmaking, be it in the global level, national level, or local, regional level. The challenges we have and the opportunities also we have. And as you know, this COVID-19 lockdowns throughout the world and even in India have almost stalled the filmmaking process. I think I should be not talking about it in the later end of the my talk. And as you know, It is a global phenomenon, and we have been pinched with lockdowns and economic setbacks throughout the world, and especially in India. Anyway, right now, filmmakers and film fraternity have been idle, I would say, or have not been doing any work. That's the scenario, and people are not flocking to the cinema halls. That's another scenario. So with this, I should be actually talking about the process of filmmaking in the period where digitalization was not had not arrived. Till 2005, or more or less between 2003 to 2005, we used to make films with celluloid stock, film stock, and they used to come in huge reels, and we used to have 35mm CinemaScope and 70mm, 16mm, 8mm films and all. These films were reels, film reels, film negatives, and we used to shoot our films in film negatives, and then print them like we print photograph negative to a positive print. We used to print the films into positives, and then we used to edit. We used to edit and bring out the film and put it onto cinema halls, where film positives, they were also actually reels. You must have seen in certificates, 15 reels, 16 reels, Chole was 22 reels, like that. So we used to project those films in cinema halls, putting those reels in the projectors. That was till 2003, 2005 and all. So the whole process of filmmaking has changed. So digital digital filmmaking has arrived almost 15 years ago, and this is the technology we are using now. We are not at all using film cameras or film negatives or film projectors to show these films. So later, when we digitalize the filmmaking, projectors, digital projectors came into showing films. Many film theaters, or almost all film theaters, they removed their, or they junked their old projectors and planted digital projectors, film projectors. Even digital film projectors did not last long. They were there hardly for about 4 or 5 years, and then we have now arrived at satellite projection. This is the in thing which is running since about 8 to 10 years almost. So we actually give it to satellite, or we upload the film to satellite, to our satellite, and the satellite will stream the films to the cinema halls, to on the onto the film screens. So this is the scenario. Now the satellite uploading is done by certain agencies. You might have heard Cube and other agencies. These agencies actually upload our films to satellite, and then they stream the films to whatever, whichever the film theaters that have booked that film to show it in their cinema halls. That's the scenario now. So now let us see the impetus that gave, what was the impetus that gave to digital filmmaking and exhibition? This is an important this thing. What was the motivation? What was the impetus that gave to digitalize the film industry, film making process, and also film showing process, that is exhibition? So now look at the chronology of this technology updating from celluloid filmmaking to filmmaking and exhibition to digital filmmaking to digital projection and finally to satellite projection. From celluloid filmmaking to exhibition to digital filmmaking to digital projection and then to finally satellite projection. What does it really imply? Well, I can see it clearly that in order to arrive at satellite projection, the whole process of filmmaking and exhibition was largely digitized. Otherwise, there was no necessity for film industry or filmmaking to be digitalized at all. In order to arrive at satellite projection, screening your films through satellite, downloading the satellite signals and streaming it onto the film screens. This was the ultimate goal of digitalization. And to accommodate that, the whole process of film making was digitalized. Nowadays, you do not find manufacturing of film rolls at all. Even you might have seen even still films, that is photographic films, are also not being manufactured. The same way is with the films also. So see, this was actually a part of the process of the whole world turning into digital. It was not just film industry turning into digital or filmmaking turning into digital. At the same time, between 2000 and 2005, you might have seen many of the processes in the or economic activities in the world turned digital. Governance, telecommunication, education, healthcare, banking, and many other services. Many other services turned into digital. This was one thing. And entertainment, especially cinema, was the major entertainment. Even today, it's the major entertaining medium. So cinema was also not an exception. So it also turned digital. Now, why did the world change to digital? Not only cinema, but to all other services and governance and other aspects of life. Why did it change? I think there is a valid reason behind this. And also we will discuss why cinema industry also changed to digital. So in this during the turn of this millennium, that is from 2000 onwards, the whole economic order of the world began changing drastically. You might have observed this. Capitalism began spreading throughout the world, subduing every other system of economics. Capitalism began spreading throughout the world, subduing every other system of economics. And capitalism, in order to thrive, in order to survive and thrive, in order to make more profits, it has to monopolize every economic activity. This is a very major turn that we saw through the spread of capitalism. Now, the process of economic globalization kickstarted this monopolization. Capitalism, in order to thrive, has to monopolize every economic activity, and the process of economic globalization kickstarted this monopolization. So this economic globalization was brought through GATT, IMF, and the World Bank. So this was the process, and digitalization was used as a tool for monopolization. This is the whole crux of affairs. Digitalization was used as a tool for monopolization. Now, cinema being the largest entertainer, television was already a medium controlled by the satellite communication. So cinema had to be brought under satellite communication. That is why satellite projection was brought in, and hence the globalization process started in filmmaking, because it would bring about the monopoly of the film industry. That was it. And now let's see the impact of digitalization at national level or regional level, and the challenges it has posed and the opportunities it has opened. Now let me divide this into two portions. One, production of films, the impact of digitalization in the production of films, and the impact of digitalization in the exhibition of films. Let me take exhibition of films, digitalization of exhibition of films first, and the impacts by digitalization. So the impact of digitalization on the film exhibition is this. With streaming of films into cinema screens through a satellite, the exhibition was largely monopolized. Earlier, owners of cinema houses were nearly independent. You know, owners of cinema houses, in the sense you had one or two cinema halls, cinema theaters in almost every small towns, and big cities like Bangalore, Mysore, and all, they had hundreds of theaters. All these theater owners called exhibitors. These exhibitors were more or less independent. They had the choice of choosing which film to show in their cinema halls. That is the thing. And but with the satellite exhibition, they were actually tied to film streaming agencies that I talked about earlier. These film streaming agencies, upload the film and put it onto the cinema halls, these exhibitors had to depend on the streaming agencies, and they had to make a contract with them. So the streaming agencies, whichever the films they had, the exhibitors had to choose among those films only. It's not like, Kesari Harwo has made a film, or some other fellow has made a film, so let me put that film. No, this choice or this freedom, the exhibitor lost. This is the major, setback for the exhibition sector, due to monopoly and digitalization. So the same is with, you can see a parallel that is going on throughout the world. Agriculture, for example. In fact, these days, corporate farming is coming into practice, or the governances are trying to bring corporate farming as this thing. Like, you are the owner of the land, and a corporate can lease your land and decide what it grows and sell to what the price it should sell, and give you a royalty, or give you a lease money to the landowner. This is the kind of setup we are now facing in even in Karnataka and India. So you might have seen in many newspapers, heard or seen the news that cooperative sector has been the policy of cooperative sector has been modified, and many other policies have been modified to accommodate corporate farming, corporates leasing out farmers' lands, and this thing. See, what happens with this is the farmer will not lose his land, but he will lose all the rights over his land. The same thing is happening to the medical industry and education, healthcare, housing, and many other sectors. See, this is the corporatization of the whole this thing. And digitization was the tool used for this corporate monopoly, corporatization and corporate monopoly. So this digitization is is affecting the same way to the film industry as any other sector. The whole the process of making films are left to us, but the inputs are given by the corporate world, and the profits are also largely taken by the corporate world. The risk factors are left to the filmmakers. That's the thing. So now, with the this is the thing happening in exhibition sector. So whatever the major corporates that procure films, buy films from producers, are upstreamed into or uplinked into satellites, and they are downstreamed into the cinema halls. This is the process. So with control of exhibition, the whole control of the film industry is taking place. So the production is not in your hands now. When you have when you are an independent filmmaker, you will have to have a lot of struggle with these things to put your films onto cinema halls. That's the process. So now, coming to the impact of digitalization on the production of films, digital filmmaking, it was said that it would be cheaper. You don't have to really buy film negatives, costly, expensive film negatives, and process them and put them on and put them onto film positives, which again is a very expensive process. You do not have to actually do that. So it promised to be cheaper than shooting with celluloid stock. Yes, we do not buy expensive negative stocks now, and we have the cost as we store. We do save a lot of cost as we store the footages in digital media. Otherwise, we used to store them in film positives, film negatives and film positives, sound negatives and sound positives. No, we do not do that now. We store in digital media. So we may save some money here, but actually the digital process, the digitalization process has so has been so expensive in the post-production this thing. Post-production has become highly expensive now. So this and another factor is that you have to spend a huge amount of time, at least four times time non-digital filmmaking on post-production. That is, you in terms of time and money, your production process has expanded to almost four times. Now you will have to do digital integration of the film that you are ultimately showing it to the audience. That is, you will have to correct the color, you have to grade the film, you have to do many things. Well, we used to do all this even in the analog era, but this process in digitalization, it takes a longer process and it costs more money. That's the thing. And sound design. Sound has emerged as a major component of films. Sounds were actually was a major component of films even before the digital era. Even we had silent era in the filmmaking movies, and after the silent era we introduced sound into films. And this sound is important, all right, but coming to the digital era, the precision of sound technology has been so minute, has been so widespread, that it needs every digital sound, every bit of a sound, every byte of a sound has to be taken care of, has to be processed in a proper way. So it takes a lot of time, in terms of putting your dialogues, putting your sound effects, and also the background music. So all these things, they have added up to the cost and time consumption. And in terms of digital integration, well, you now have CG, computer generated graphic works. See, these computer generated graphic works that are introduced into films also cost a lot of money and consume a lot of time. Now, even if you do not make an animation in the film or make a special effect in the film, there are some graphic processes that involve in modern filmmaking, in digital filmmaking. Even if you do not have even a simple graphic shown on the film, you will have to graphically treat the film, digital film, that you are as a final output. That itself is even, for example, a title, titling of the film itself takes a lot of time, and it is a graphic work today. Earlier, it was not so. So all these things, and then finally, uploading the film to satellite and streaming back to cinema halls. This again is a hectic process and a cost-consuming process. So the cost of production has never been brought down by digitalization at all. So if you really want to make a competent film that can be shown in cinema halls throughout the world, earlier we used to spend about 70% of our film budget on film shooting and about 30% on the post-production. But now it is the reverse. We almost spend about 40% on film production and about 60% of our budget on post-production. So that is the thing. And we used to spend about 5 to 6 months or maximum 8 months to make a film. Nowadays, it takes about 1.5 to 2 years to make a film. That's the thing. And now, secondly, all these expenditures are almost same for every kind of film, whether you make a small budget film, a medium budget film, or a high budget film. The cost of post-production remains the same almost. So that is it. But well, again, if you really want to make a competent film, technically competent film, and aesthetically competent film, to show it in cinema halls. Whether you have a star or not, whether you have a newcomer, whatever this thing, whether you shoot it in a small camera or whether you shoot it in a high resolution, very high resolution digital camera, the post-production takes a lot of work, takes a lot of work, money, and time. And now, in the exhibition sector, it is highly expensive to upload your film to a satellite and then stream it in just about 20 or 25 cinema halls. When you have incurred so much of cost on uploading your film into a satellite, When you have your audience potential to about 20 to 25 cinema halls, then the whole process is it becomes much, much more costlier to you. So even regional films are thinking of streaming their films in at least 100, 200 cinema halls, or better even in 1,000, 2,000 cinema halls at a single time. So that is the, this thing. So even regional films are weighing the option of, making very big budget films. Like in Canada, you had this KGF, Kurukshetra and all. See, why did these people in a small Kannada industry like Kannada film industry, they spent about 50 to 60 crores on these films, and why did they try to expand their audience? It is because to cover the cost. It is because to cover the cost. And it is because to match the cost of match the investment with the returns. Well, this investment has to be there, whether you make a small film, a medium budget film, or a high budget film. This is one of the major these things that digitalization has brought in. Now, This can only happen if your film is star-studded. If your film is does not have an amount of audience, then you have no avenue to show your films. That is the crux of affairs now. See, in 2019, about 320 and odd films were produced in Kannada film industry, and hardly about 150 films were released. They saw the light of the screen. So another 170 odd films, they could not release at all. Where do they go? That's the kind of digital digitalization has brought into the film industry. Now, these star-studded films, they somehow survive, or they compete and survive. They cannot afford to do experiments, and they have to adhere to the proven box office formulas. What are the proven box office formulas? Proven box office formulas are Hollywood films or Bollywood films. So if you make a regional film, you will have to match your formula to a Hollywood film or a Bollywood film. This is the scenario which is highly discouraging for small regional and native cultural films. That's one thing. And in this monopoly scenario, many regional film industries have almost ceased their filmmaking activity. Now, say for example, Assamese film, Bhojpuri film, Gujarati film, Punjabi film, or any other films. North Indian states, many film industries are not functioning since almost 10 years. Or if they are functioning, they are functioning on a very small, minuscule scale. That's it. And regionals, and second thing is, regional stars are now competing with Bollywood stars. Like, a Kannada star is competing with a Bollywood star, and Bollywood is competing with the Hollywood. That's the scenario. And no matter whether they succeed or not, they have to compete with the this thing. Now, even the mainstream Kannada film industry becomes an off-stream Kannada film industry when you compare to a Bollywood. Bollywood becomes the mainstream, and this is an off-stream. This becomes an off-stream industry, and Hollywood becomes the mainstream, and Bollywood becomes a off-stream industry in terms of Hollywood. So this kind of competition has brought the regional representation of cinema into almost a standstill. This is the scenario in terms of film industry. Now, in this process, filmmaking becomes more of an economic activity than a work of art or a representation of a region or a language or a culture or even a creative work of a filmmaker. This is the kind of scenario that we have today when you consider film industry as a way of life or your practice. And audiences, the audiences now, they just become consumers than participating cine goers. Earlier, many audiences, regional audiences, they used to participate in the cinema halls. The participation was such in the cinema halls and after viewing the film. The participation was such huge that we had a lot of feedback from the audiences. Nowadays, it is not so. A consumer is just a consumer. It's like going to when he is hungry, he goes to Darshini restaurant, eats a dosa or two idli and a vada and comes back and fills his stomach. That's the kind of thing. And if he's if he really wishes to watch a movie, hundreds of films are available. He just goes to a film theater and watches and comes back, forgets the next moment. So that's it. So he becomes a consumer. Consumerism has spread to the entertainment also, which is which has its own major implications. So what the film industry really has done is the digitalization of film industry has really put a major this thing on the art films too. The art films are generally they are regional films, and that is films that practice the art of cinema, or which have a purpose, or which a filmmaker finds an expression to express his thoughts through the film medium. So these art house cinemas are parallel cinemas, we call. These parallel cinemas have a very different kind of impact on impact from digitalization of films. Earlier, these art films, say for example, our own art films like Pather Panchali, made by Satyajit Ray, or the art films made by Shyam Benegal, Adur Gopalakrishnan, Girish Kasaravalli, and all. See, all these art films, they had, these filmmakers, they had their own form, found to make films. Satyajit Ray had a distinct form for himself. He was an artist by himself. He had a distinct form. Adur Gopalakrishnan has a distinct form to make films. So the screenplays, the films of Satyajit Ray or Adur Gopalakrishnan cannot be seen as films of same genre or films of same format. The forms and content used to differ between filmmakers, creative filmmakers. But with digitalization, many programs have now come. For an upcoming filmmaker, many programs throughout the world have come to support good cinema. And many script writing workshops, many funding, film funding workshops, and film funding agencies have come up throughout the world. You can, as a debut filmmaker or as an upcoming filmmaker, you can apply with your script with these many you know, funding agencies, and they expect you to see that your film is made in a format that is reachable to a universal audience, a global audience. This is the major this thing. So your content may be yours, but the form of the way that you tell your content in a film has to be universal. It cannot be a Kannada film. Say for example, let us take a very distinct folk art or folk music of Karnataka, like Kamsale. When you want to make a film on Kamsale, or when you want to make a film on some other folk art, or when you want, if you want to make a film on a very particular story of Kannada, for Kannadigas, made by Kannadigas, you cannot do it now. If you want to really put it onto the film audiences, you will have to adhere to a certain format. Even your art has to adhere to a certain format if you want to get it funded and get it exhibited in many international film festivals and many international avenues where you can show your films. So the same film, the Bhumigita that I made about 20 years ago, had I had evolved a form for the film. The same Bhumigita, if I make now, cannot be made in the same format. It has to be on an international format that can reach an Italian sitting in Rome, or African sitting in his hometown. So this digitalization has brought universality in gaining your audience, but it has to be in the format that reaches him, that makes him understand, that makes him follow your film. So your regionality in terms of content and form is being lost. You cannot really make a film for your own audience now. If you really a good film, art house cinema or a parallel cinema for your own audience, you will have to reach out to a global audience. If you have to recover your cost, you will have to take that format and make a film, be it your content. So this is a major this thing. And another thing is digitalization has democratized filmmaking. It has transferred the risk to every filmmaker, but corporate worlds have been giving their inputs to you and taking away the profit for the filmmaker and the film audiences to take the risks. That's it. So, well, audiences do not actually take much of a risk, but filmmakers do take a lot of risk. If your film is not viable, whether it is art film or whether it's a formula film or a commercial film, whichever format you make, if your film is not viable, they will not take your film at all for the theatrical release or television or OTT platforms and all. So it is your wish to make a film, and it is our wish to take the film or not. That's the kind of thing. But earlier it was not so. A film industry like Kannada film industry had a very very good relationship, the producer, distributor and exhibitor. This relationship is lost now. Now filmmaking is universalized. Anyone can make a film with a mobile camera. And if it is competent enough to show it into a cinema, in a cinema hall, it will be taken. Again, for that, many other factors come into picture. You know, whether it is a star-studded film, whether it is a thriller, whether it is that, this, and all. So all these things, all these factors, really have actually democratized filmmaking, but they have the business has been centralized and monopolized. So the film industry has been centralized and monopolized, and the profit is centralized and monopolized, whereas the risks of filmmaking has been transferred to the filmmakers. So that way it is democratized. Anybody can be a filmmaker today. And whether you succeed as a filmmaker, whether you succeed with your audiences, depends on not just your audiences, but all other corporate factors, all other corporate entities. Your success to a film is given more by corporate entities than your audiences. Yet there are some great opportunities too. If you really want to be an independent filmmaker and not be a part of the film industry. So now, what are the opportunities? Well, digitalization now has given ample opportunities to show your film sitting in Bangalore or some other city. Sitting here, you can show it to the whole of the world. You can actually identify your audiences throughout the world. This is the major opportunity that digitalization has thrown. That's one thing. And you can show it, you can webcast it, or you can put it onto some OTT platform, anything. So you have ample chances of showing your films to your audiences. Identify your audiences, make a network of your audiences, grow your audiences, make your film for those audiences. That's one thing. And if you are really a dedicated and highly competent filmmaker, as I told you earlier, there are many agencies globally which can assess your film beforehand and fund your film, and also help you show. Ultimately, it's the creator who decides who wants what he wants to create. It's not a corporate world, it's not a thing or any other agency. So it is the creator who decides what he wants to create. No power on earth can monopolize the art of Pandit Ravi Shankar, or the pen of Gabriel Garcia Marquez. That's it. So you have ample opportunities now for create, and digitalization has given a lot of opportunities and room for enhancing your creativity. That is also there. So earlier, creativity was limited because of the shooting budget constraints. Now the shooting budget can be drastically reduced and your creativity can be enhanced. And you can actually make a small budget film with your own this thing. If you do not want to really go to a cinema or go to a cinema industry to actually show the film to the audiences, you can create your own audiences online or otherwise offline and make your own films. Film industry, filmmaking has been affordable now than earlier. But digital industry as such has been monopolized, and the profits are being appropriated by the corporate houses. That's the kind of scenario we have. Well, I think I will stop here and open it for discussion. Hope I have been clear in what I'm saying. So if there are any discussions, please come. And people who really want to ask in Kannada, welcome. ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಕೇಳಿ, ನಾನು ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲೂ ಉತ್ತರ ಕೊಡಲಿಕ್ಕೆ ಪ್ರಯತ್ನ ಪಡ್ತೀನಿ. ದೋಸ್ ಹೂ ಯುನೋ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್, ಐ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಆನ್ಸರ್ ದಮ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್.
We have many questions lined up for you, sir, and you know, all audience seem to be electrified by your very intellectual presentation, and with a high resolution camera panning across the entire industry. Okay, and you know, one question is from Sunil, a research scholar from Coimbatore University. So we can see nowadays a lot of students, because of digital platform is open for them, a lot of young people are interested in movies, but they don't see a place to project their output. Okay, so there is no platform to telecast or put their output, except a few. So what is your suggestion on this, sir?
Well, as I told you, a budding filmmaker nowadays has to struggle a lot, has to make a very great, very good, very huge amount of homework. I would not say very good homework, a huge, huge amount of homework, and he will have to learn filmmaking the hard way. And after learning filmmaking, well, if he really wants to jump into film industry, probably he will be lost. What I suggest him is, he will have to, try to make his film so that it reaches to a global audience without the film industry backing. If he goes for a film industry backing, probably, he will end up, making a film that a film industry wants. That's it. So now, since the filmmaking is democratized, since every filmmaker, every man, every person can become a filmmaker, he can really make a film. But like this, many people have made their first film, second films, which are not competent enough even for a small chunk of audience. They if you come out with an incompetent film, probably you will end up nowhere. Before making your film, research well, learn filmmaking well, and then apply to many global agencies that are available online, and send your draft scripts to them. If they like, they call you to a program, and they actually train you to make a competent script. And if the script is really competent, probably you will have ample chances, or if you are lucky, you will have chances that your film is being funded for production. And if the film again goes well, probably your film will see a lot of film festivals, and then there is a good chunk of screening. And this is the process of new filmmakers who have to arrive now. And when you arrive like this, the film industry will have an eye on you and it will pick you up. That's it. So probably start with short films, and come to and take a good experience there, and then try for a full-length feature film. And documentaries are also a wonderful filmmaking option. So start with short films and documentaries, and you will have a lot of experience, on hand work experience, and then you can try large filmmaking, full-length filmmaking venture.
This is a question from Dr. Prashant Ji Malur. There are, we see a lot of big budget movies failing in the box office, and sometimes low budget movies becoming a big success there. So we see a fight between the content and the budget. So what do you suggest there?
Come again, please.
There are low budget movies becoming a success, yes, and high budget movies sometimes facing a loss in the box office. And we see this fight between budget and the story. So what is more important now, the style, content, or the budget?
Oh, well, okay, it depends. A low budget film can be a huge success, and a high budget can be a flop. You are talking it in terms of recovery of your investment or business making. Well, when it comes to content and when it comes to how you put that content in a cinematic form, the budget does not become a criteria. It is not a criteria. The presentation of your content in a film, if it catches the pulse of an audience, it is always there. Well, even before digitalization, that is the same thing. A big budget film used to flop sometimes, and a small budget film used to this thing. But here is a catch. A small budget film, but a very good film, can be killed in terms of business by corporate worlds. Whereas a very incompetent high budget film can make a profit if the corporate world minds. That's it. So say for example. We saw this film Thithi in Canada about 2 years ago. Thithi was a huge critical success throughout the world, and Thithi did not make much money in terms of theatrical release. It made it recovered its money. Otherwise, that's a different thing. But theatrical release. In theatrical release, Thithi was not given a proper exhibition at all, proper release at all. This is a major example we have with us.
We have a question from Varna. In this digital takeover of the traditional film industry, what are the opportunities for young generation? Because they are all looking for careers, okay, or looking for stardoms. So, therefore, yes. What are the opportunities for the young minds?
Yeah, okay. I'm addressing the young people only. Young people who want to become filmmakers, and they can definitely become competent filmmakers. As I told you earlier, they have to dedicate themselves as budding filmmakers. They have to come to the mold of becoming budding filmmakers. Their first film is extremely important. Extremely important. Very start with short films and documentaries, and your first full-length feature film is very important. That either kills you as a filmmaker or launches you as a filmmaker. So you do your homework well and learn filmmaking very well, and not just filmmaking. Well, people just say, okay, the mechanical thing of shooting, editing, and post-production, all these processes are just processes. But filmmaking is not just these processes. It is a process of bringing yourself out onto screen. Emotions, yeah, bringing yourself to the screen, bringing your emotions out to the screen, putting it in audio and visual language. How you best put it is the actual process of filmmaking. This process of filmmaking has to be explored by the filmmaker himself. He has to explore within. And when he explores it, however effort he puts in bringing out his own thing, into the film is no, actually that may decide the quality of the film or the acceptance of the film.
Okay.
So okay, coming to your no, coming to your
next question.
Make your films, short films, and then with a good background and a good experience, work experience, try your first feature film so that at least some 5 to 6 international film festivals recognize your film, take it into their program of film festival. That's most important. So when you do that, you get a recognition as a filmmaker, your film gets a recognition as a filmmaker, as a film. So with that recognition, you will have to actually attempt in a higher way for your second film. You know, approach many funding agencies then, and many funding programs, not agencies, funding programs then. Approach many script writing labs, post-production labs, production labs, you know, fundraising labs. That way there are many opportunities today for young filmmakers, budding filmmakers to come to the field and make this thing. Again, it depends on the market, on the monopolized film industry, whether to show your film or not. Again, there is no restriction in making a film. Making a film is today very easy than, so I do not discourage anyone, but they have to make sure that they can be competent filmmakers if they really want to make film making as their career. And their first film has to prove a lot. It has to promise, he has to promise that he becomes a good filmmaker in the future. Then only the film going audience or the film watching audience throughout the world watches you, recognizes you. Thereby you grow your audience.
Okay, shall we go to the next question, sir? There is a question from Aaron Meneses from MRC Mysuru, Srinivas Pajataya from Mudibidri, and again one principal Simon Varghese, I think one principal. Okay, they have asked the same question about the OTT platforms. When Amazon and Netflix are all buying straight from the producers the movies, you know, don't you think then this will influence the industry and the producers and like that? What would be the impact?
Okay, what OTT platforms? I think these OTT platforms are going to be with us for a long time. Probably cinemas or films in cinema halls in the later years, but OTT films, OTT platforms are going to stay with us. We are going to have online film screenings, online watching online films, paying online and watching films that we are doing even today. So this is going to stay. And again, these OTT platforms are offering all kind of films, you know, low budget films and high budget films, and they are actually expecting a technical competence of a high budget film from a low budget film also. So this is it, and this is one way killing the filmmakers' urge also, or the filmmakers' this thing also. But again, what is the second part of your question?
Yeah, how is it going to affect the producers and the industry?
Producers, well, again, a producer today is like a farmer, as I said. you know, whether it gets released in a cinema hall or not is a million dollar question. So if at all it gets released in cinema hall or this thing, probably you will have to spend more money or almost equal money on what you have spent on production, in releasing, in putting your film onto theater and publicizing it and drawing your audiences. This is one thing. And secondly, OTT platforms, OTT platforms, they will stay. I think cinema halls today, even in the after the COVID 19 this thing, many people are afraid going to cinema halls and watch the films. And even in lockdowns, OTT platforms brought the films to us in to our homes, and not televisions and OTT platforms. So television and OTT platform become the major avenues for watching films. That is going to be there, and cinema halls probably will exist, will survive the this COVID-19 pandemic, and they get open up this thing. But how many people really have time nowadays in this modern world to go to a cinema hall, spend more money on to watch a film and more time to watch a film? So that's a question. Many people today are preferring OTT platforms and televisions to watch films. So cinema halls will remain for some time if they survive COVID-19 scenario. But that will be a major event, like you go to a pilgrimage, or like you go to a tourist spot to visit. That would be the kind of this thing. So that is why Hollywood actually tried to make films that cannot be watched on television, in order to get the full experience of a film. They actually tried to make mega blockbusters, such huge technological extravaganza and was brought into the films, that they become pale in on a TV screen. That was the technique the Hollywood did about 20 years ago, when television was the in thing in America and Europe and many other places. But again, cinema halls are day by day losing their significance in terms of OTT platforms, in terms of your computers, in terms of your home theaters, having very good sound and picture quality. So you can have a very good home theater in your own house, take a OTT this thing and watch your film like you watch in a cinema hall. So cinema halls probably will survive for some more time, for a decade or so. And I really do not know the future of cinema halls. But OTT platforms and television streaming of films, and also home theaters, are already in thing. They will stay for longer. Varghese, your microphone, your microphone.
Okay, Sibandi Padmanabha, and the seven people have raised the same concern. Is the era of this screen is over? I think you have answered them, and the other seven people have asked the same question about death of screens and the birth of digital screens. So you have answered these, and now there is a question from Father William Marshall from Mangalore, and he is asking, you have suggested that presenting local culture in the movies would be troublesome in this modern era. Then how to do it? Then it is a death of popularizing the local culture. So what is your take on that, sir?
Well, that's a challenge and an opportunity also for you. It's a challenge because the whole world is asking you today to make a format that is universal, whether whatever the content is not the thing, but the format in which the content has to be put is being slowly or is being gradually monitored by the global funding agencies and all. But if you are a true artist, like as I told you earlier, like Pandit Ravi Shankar, or an author like Marquis, you cannot be controlled by any formula or any controller. You can be a master of yourself. So it's a challenge for you as well as an opportunity. If you can bring your content, your local content, your cultural content in a form that is local, most cultural, that can appeal to a very universal audience, then you have made a wonderful landmark in cinema making, film making. So you have the opportunities highly open for you. It is how you use it. That's why I said, a small-time filmmaker or a negligent filmmaker probably cannot survive today. A highly creative filmmaker and a highly competent filmmaker, whether he is in the industry or whether he is independent, can survive with his creativity, with his content, and with his own form. But again, the monopolizing corporate sector, what it does is it monopolizes for some time, or it controls you to some extent. But when you are actually providing much more than what it is expecting, now it falls at your feet and it grabs you. It tries to own you then. And what you say becomes the rule. That's it. So break the rule in cinema is a major this thing. So when you break a rule, probably you are making a rule in cinema, in filmmaking. That way, a creative person cannot be controlled. So that's the greatest opportunity the digitalization of cinema has given.
Yes, there is a Sharatlal asking a question. For example, now we have seen a lot of short movies, like 3 minutes, 4 or 5 minutes movies, and all created by very young people. And we see especially a lot of them coming from Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and some other states. So he thinks that is a great opportunity that digitalization has given to young people for making these new movies, small movies that attracts thousands of audience, and they make a lot of money too. What is your take on this, sir?
YouTube and Facebook, they have given a lot of opportunities for young filmmakers to make videos. So again, videos are very different from films. Hitherto, I was talking film as a medium of art and craft and creativity. So a video that goes on a Facebook or YouTube channel may become viral and may earn a lot of subscribers, and thereby it may make a good money. But film as an art, film as a discipline, is very different from video making. If you can understand this, differentiate between practicing a medium and putting a video that can go viral. If you can understand, or if you can spot the difference between these two, probably you have the answer for yourself.
Yeah, now there's a question from Vishal Naik. How about crowdfunding to avoid this lot of loss for the producers? How about crowdfunding?
Crowdfunding, yes. Crowdfunding even in Canada, one or two films produced by crowdfunding have come. It is a very good option, but it is, I don't know if it works always. It's a good option. You know, well, if there are some 100 people who want to make a film, and who want to put a story onto a film, probably those 100 people can fund the film itself and then make a film. That's a very good option, and the risks are divided. But I don't know if it really works always. And I would suggest another form of crowdfunding is cooperative film production. This is a very organized way of crowdfunding. Make a cooperative and put your become members to the cooperative, pool funds, make films, exhibit films, and also keep making films and be in the business. Cooperative filmmaking is much more viable and affordable and a welcome move in terms of filmmaking than crowdfunding. In a crowdfunding, what you do is you actually pull all the money. A producer pulls money from the crowd, and he will be the ultimate decider, or he will be the ultimate benefactor. So when he makes a profit, well, it will be distributed to the people who have funded. But in a cooperative filmmaking, everything is legalized, and all these things all these members can really have a word on the film, this thing, and then on decision making, and it can survive for long. A crowdfunding can happen for one film and it need not continue for the second film, whereas in a cooperative the pooled membership continues for long if filmmaking through that cooperative becomes profitable. If it can, if those films can bring back money, bring back investment with some profit, cooperative filmmaking is more preferable than crowdfunding.
Yeah, there are a lot of monopolization of the hero roles and heroine roles in Indian movie screens. So a lot of young talents and from villages are ascribing to come to the silver screen. How can they come in, sir? Because the industry is in a way blocking them from coming in. So it's a from Sibandi Padmanabha, and then two more have asked the same thing, because again after digitalization it's very difficult again to come to the film world. So is there any way out?
I don't know. Well, people who have talent really make it somehow to the film industry, and if they are lucky, I myself do not believe in luck. But if they are lucky, well, they really can shine well also. But the material that you have, I do not actually see an actor or an actress as a heroine or a hero. No, I do not actually see them as hero or heroines. Every person, every actor in on screen that appears on screen is an actor, whether he has a small role or a bigger role. But the formula of filmmaking, probably sometimes it uses certain formulas where it projects one or two characters and make them as heroes. So actors, they can find their own these things, and even they can try making short films and act in their, if they are confident in their talent, they can act in their films, and then they can show it to the, that becomes a showreel for the major producers. And then well, if the producer and the director opts in to take that particular actor, then he's in. So it's not a thing. Well, again, how you approach and what is there inside you, it really counts.
So many questions are pouring in, but mostly, you know, some main dimension of the answers you have given already. One question that came just different now is the problems faced by women in the film industry, you know, because of digitalization and general, they face a lot of trouble. So is there any, you know, added problems they face due to digitalization?
No, no. What? How does it connect with problems of women and digitalization?
That is, we have to discuss. So, is there any added issues that they face because of digitalization? You know, and is there any like general problems women face in the film industry?
I don't know how to answer this, but like women, many people in the film industry will have no problems. You know, because not just film industry, any establishment, you know, tries to exploit the employees. So you know, that's the kind of scenario we have in every kind of industry, not just film industry. And film industry also has certain problems in terms of, you know, handling of you know, human beings, their crew, their you know, cast, many other these things. So it is a societal problem than industry problem. And if the society you know, addresses these problems, film industry also automatically addresses these problems. That's the thing. And it also depends on individual. How an individual, what is his, her, or her stands on certain issue, and how does he or she you know, face the society. It's a give and take between an individual and a society, not just a film industry and a budding actor or actress. No.
Okay, I think we have a wonderful time with Mr. Kesari Harvu, the well-known director producer of Bhoomi Kita, and definitely we were wonderstruck with the silver screen and its issues. And definitely some points he suggested are, you know, really food for thinking, because the entire industry is undergoing a transformation, and the producers are really, you know, feeling the heat of this transition from traditional film producing process to digital film producing process, and the risks that are involved in this process, and the problems, and you know, the uncertainty. Earlier when they make a movie, definitely they were sure that they can hit the screen, but even if they invest a lot because of a lot of mafia intervention, and again digital problems raised by digitalization, you know, we come to know that 170 movies in Karnataka itself could not be screened the last year, and this is an alarming situation, you know, for it's a food for thinking also for young producers, you know. That is, you know, really what is that, threatening and scaring. And but there are still, you know, bright days ahead, because you know, there are so many people now, they are watching movies, but they don't go to theaters. That's the problem for the producers, but they watch all these movies, and definitely the medium of cinema will never get over. It will be ever powerful, ever tremendous, and you know, they will rule the world and minds. But the issues are you know, changing. The problems are changing, and it is for the creative minds to find solutions to these problems. And definitely, producers like, you know, and directors like Kesari Harbo will find, you know, really find these problems as opportunities. And definitely, we are waiting for his three feature films, short feature films on farmers and their environmental issues. That's, you know, still in the, you know, lab. And definitely, we all audience wait to watch them, sir. And I ask, I request all the audience also to watch Bhoomi Geetha. And personally, I watched it more than 3-4 times, and it's a wonderful production. And definitely, you know, our congratulations to you for producing such a beautiful movie, sir. And definitely, Kannada film industry is ever indebted to you for making such good movies. Definitely, if not stop with just 2 or 4, we want to see ever more movies from you. And we wait to see them all. And now to audience, and thank you for participating in this webinar. And thank you, Mr. Kesari Harbo, for joining us. And he was a good friend of our department. And when we asked, he never said, you know, no. And that was he made this day a wonderful day, and this session an ever beautiful learning experience. Thank you, sir. And thank you for your time.
Thank you all the participants who have joined and listened to me. It was a great opportunity provided by the Coimbatore University and your department, Professor Varghese and Professor Poonananda. So I thank you all, and let's hope to continue this again and again.
Thank you.
There are hundreds of congratulations coming to you. One from Jayaprakash from Coimbatore. He said he has not attended such a beautiful session for the last 7 years. So that's a beautiful, and there are a lot of congratulatory notes coming in. So all this, you know, art user, and all these congratulations, you know, encourage you to produce more and contribute more. Thank you, sir. Thank you, audience, for joining us. Have a wonderful day. We meet at 3 o'clock now. And we will be listening to Santosh Chandrasekhar from America, and he will be dealing with, you know, the next topic. So meet you at 3 o'clock. Till then, bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.